Hello, this is Jeff with Final Boss Editing and Danielle. The Foxy Lady. So we're going to do an edit today on the Scriptshadow Amateur Friday submissions. I should actually tell them we're actually doing it. And that's the lazy man's way. There we go. Instant self-promotion. So we're doing an edit of the Amateurs Friday scripts today. We're going to pick two for based off the log lines. She may end up studying for the second half once we choose log lines. Or, depending on how interesting your script is.
I have exams this week.
She has exams this week. Going through the log lines. Picking two. Reading the first 10 pages of two. And then if they're good, continuing to read. If not... Or, you know, if we're just get sleepy, because that is 10:40 our time, then we pick one and then vote for that as the winner. And then hopefully they get voted on. All right, so let's go through them. So the first one is Kill Easy, serial killer comma thriller. Mm. A teenage girl whose parents are murdered is going... is going on the road to kill serial killers... Retaliating for her lost childhood, getting help from another serial killer, finding out this comes with prices to get paid. Right. So, I would say, you know, be sure on your log line to have perfect grammar.
And spelling.
Kill easy.
Sounds like English manner.
That's okay. Yeah, I mean, sounds a good story, but, you know.
Oh, yeah, in my country. Okay. The grammar. Sometimes when grammar is different, it's usually just because...
And usually is... Usually it's key to, you know, really have someone take a look at your grammar. Like, I know it's, you know, if you're, you know, not native tongue, that's okay. I just want to make sure I was logged in. If you're not native tongue, that's okay. But, you know, there's usually a lot of people who are really talented. You can just say, hey... You know, I know my story is good, but be sure to take a look and make sure my sentence structure is good. Also, no capitalization seems a bit odd. To consider myself close to a semi-pro-writer, considering the fact that another screenplay is now being finished in production in my country. Unclear if it will be really happening. I'm a regular visitor. Nice. I've never learned mega. That's actually pretty awesome. Mm. I have learned mega. Mm. Yeah, that I never learned mega. Wishing all the best to keep writing. Okay. Ski Furious. A female FBI agent rookie, Ryan Coolidge, infiltrates the world of extreme skiing to look for a group of stealers preying off truck robberies on the mountain roads. Seems a lot like that one... Infiltrates the world of extreme skiing looking for a group of skiers. That's kind of interesting.
Yeah. It says Fast and Furious and Point Break.
I love Point Break. That was a classic. Keanu.
I've not seen either of them, to be honest, but...
Well, shame on you. You're a bad person.
That's what they tell me.
Untitled sci-fi. Alright. A Cold Orders. Evil cat. That's the evil cat attack.
Playing in a box.
Cold Orders' first soldier is sent with a team to the quarantine city of Chicago to retrieve his estranged sister. May have found the cure-all for the Veil, an alien virus that destroyed Chicago and turned its inhabitants into vicious monsters. Hmm. I always get nervous. So, this is one thing a creative writing professor will usually tell you, is to avoid writing genre fiction if you're starting, not those you're starting off, but if you're, like, still getting your feet under you, because it's harder. Hey, Mooch!
Hey,
thanks for the email, by the way. We got your email, and Fox is doing good. She's studying, packing lots of pharmacy school into her brains.
Oh,
and, doing the Amateur Friday reads.
Yeah.
So fun stuff.
I think my cat's trying to eat a cardboard box.
And she's doing pretty good.
Yeah.
She's scared now. She ran off. Okay, cool. So this looks like kind of Point Break with, this is the sci-fi. Sci-fi, I always get nervous when people start with genre, because it's just one more thing to manage, right? So first you got to tell a good story, and then you also have to create a world. So it's like one extra thing. So like what we've read a lot in horror and sci-fi screenplays here is that usually they struggle a little bit more. And this is Untitled... log line, I'd be like, beware rare sci-fi. It adds one more task for the... Yeah. Over just telling a good story. Yeah, it's tricky, and, like, I'm learning that lesson the hard way, because I'm like, oh, wow, my story is struggling, but then I'm, you know, also struggling with world building and all these other things. So it definitely adds up quickly. The nuclear solution.
Nuclear.
That's how a man dies. I describe it as lighthearted action, but since it's not real genre, you decide. Absolutely ruining the job they were hired to do, the protagonists have to tie up a loose end to avoid getting the blame for it.
I have no idea what that's about.
Yep, she's right.
The protagonist.
Logline usually want to be specific. Be specific about your protagonist. Don't leave us guessing. Leave us with an image.
I'm like torn between whether we should read the ones that are like actually sound okay or whether we should read the ones that don't to help them more, you know?
That's true. Yeah.
I'm torn, just because usually it's like, oh, let's read what sounds good, but
I think this is
to, like, help people, right?
That's true. That is the theme of...
For the ones that look the worst.
That is the theme of this them. Amateur Friday, is to do stuff that normally is not,
For that this week? I don't know. Thoughts?
Let's do it. We may end at page 10 a few times, but...
We'll give them, you know, good advice. That's what it's all about, right?
Absolutely. So we'll pick the two ones that we would be least likely to read. But let's see, Minder. Mm-hmm. After a traumatic experience places them together, a young woman, fearful of large dogs, agrees to watch a stranger's aged dog. When she tries to find the stranger to give it back, her search becomes a dangerous and heartbreaking journey of self-discovery. Mm-hmm. Oh, sounds kind of nice. Actually, I'm kind of curious about that.
I know, me too. Maybe we'll do one that...
We'll do that one. That's what you're trying to say.
In Georgia, what?
We say nuclear.
Nuclear?
Yeah.
Nuclear. Yeah. Haha. Thanks, Mooch. Nuclear. George W. Bush.
Curses. Darn you grammarians. Your little dog, too. Yeah, and your little cat, who's... just looking for a laser to chase right now. She's like, there has to be a laser beam moving, scanning. Okay. Well, up to you. We can do... So the thing I think is going to... The one that I think is probably is going to need the most work.
I would say that the one...
Protagonist is probably... Yeah, that's probably, like, the log line, at least, that has, like, the longest way to go to be really strong. Mm-hmm. So I'll go ahead and download Nuclear Solution, and we'll see what happens. It's a pilot. Ooh, that means it's supposed to be a TV show, which is exciting.
Oh.
I'll go ahead and show the folder. Open this puppy up. Ooh. All right, so one, Nuclear Solution. Then what's number two? Moocher, do you have any thoughts? Any votes on what our second one should be?
If not, we're going to do the dog one, I think.
If not, we're going to do the dog one? Yes. Ding! So Minder, which is about kind of pets and discovery. Kill Easy.
Adventure.
I am tempted on the ski one.
Yeah, that does sound interesting. And we don't have to do, like, the worst one. I probably all need some work.
Well, I was looking at the comments early, and it seems that Minder was definitely, like, strong.
Oh, really?
Like, a top, like, really good. So I'm trying to debate between... Oh, thanks for the follower. Thanks for the follow, Devzy. Do you have any thoughts on... I like the dog one. All right, okay. Dog one it is. You got a good log line.
Yeah.
And that's the thing, what's actually...
Maybe one weak one, or, you know, who knows, maybe.
Or, yeah, it could be. One that has a not as strong log line,
yeah.
We'll say. But that actually is really indicative. So I was cheating. Shame on me. And I looked at... Oh, that's a cool picture, too. Yeah. We'll do that last because I like to save the best for last. Yeah. Or at least what I assumed. But also, a lot of the comments were really strong on Minder, which is actually interesting that if you have a good log line, it's very likely to be a good story. So, like, knowing those structure elements. And that's why log lines matter a lot. From our reading, the people with the strongest log lines almost invariably have the strongest story, right?
Mm-hmm.
Second you read that, you were like, this sounds interesting.
Or like that one about the lemon tree on Mars.
Yes. And that was like a really strong script. So it's, mm-hmm. you know, yeah, I mean, it sucks to have so much weight placed on stuff like that. But then it's like, gosh darn it. Like, you know, it works. Like, that is factually just, if you have a good log line, you know your craft better. Or at least this assumption is mm-hmm. that there's a higher likelihood that you do.
And I think it holds true that they usually do.
Yeah, and it's almost always invariably the case. I'll try to get to the page numbers in there because I like people to see the page numbers because it's actually very important.
What does the comment
say? Ooh, let me check. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and clear out Amateur Friday, and then I'm going to look at the comment. Hey, Bookfish!
Bookfish.
You caught us at the exact right time. I think that we should ride a large dog on a quest to find the owner. I think so, too.
I agree. I mean, I'm hoping for it.
Yeah, like a stallion.
How's it going, Buckfish?
How's it going? So you caught us right in time. So we're about to read Nuclear Solution, a screenplay pilot. And these are supposed to be, speaking of logline, what is this stream? Mm. So pretty much this is a stream where I used to be a script reader, and I love screenwriting, and I love good stories. So I figured I've, you know, seen a lot of good and a lot of bad and learned a few tricks in storytelling over the years of doing it. And I love Scriptshadow, so I figured I would piggyback on Scriptshadow's amateur offerings, and also people have submitted stuff for me to edit, and go through and do a development edit, which is usually an edit where you're talking about story themes, you're talking about more story structure issues. So not going to be super line item detail, but I'll usually read through someone else's story. Sometimes I'll do my own stuff as well, but I read through someone else's story, give comments, and then you know, hopefully kind of wrap it up. In this case, we're actually going to vote for a winner or one to be edited by Scriptshadow.
And I think this week they're particularly, I mean, it's like a, what was it called, help?
Yeah, the people that probably need help on their stuff. So you may actually vote for the one that needs the most help.
Amateur night, apparently.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Congrats. Well, wow. Good luck. Screenwriting is a wonderful, wonderful genre. If you ever get into it, feel free to send over your stuff and we'll edit. All right. So interior mansion night.
Why does it say teaser at the top?
I don't know. I think that's a faux pas. That's like, don't do stuff. So the title page, good. Normally you just want straight carrier. I would almost never do anything funky. It's just my, my thing. It's like, I don't know, title page, just have straight carrier. No font changes. And then for the page one, just cut this out. Oh, it's from Cairo. Wow. Awesome. Heliopolis, the city of the sun.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds pretty...
That's pretty cool.
That's badass on its own. Majin Buu test. Hey, Majin Buu, how's it going?
Hey. Interestingly themed stream.
We try. We shoot for just random stuff.
Yeah. We also stream RPG playing.
That friendly voice. Which is Mitch is saying that we have the voice for radio. I used to actually work in a radio show when I was in college. Yeah. I loved it. It was actually the most fun. Getting people calling in and saying funny things. Never was boring, that was for sure. So I'm going to go ahead and put my logline notes down at the bottom so you guys can see as we're diving into nuclear. Sorry, my Texan is going to show through strong here. And we'll go from here. So then this will be our edit on nuclear, and we'll start. So page one, teaser. These types of epithets, teaser, cut, like, you know, cut to, insert. Insert's okay because it's critical for the story, but those types of things you just want to avoid. So I would almost cut teaser. Interior mansion, night. I would also specify what room in the mansion because I just don't know. So in those scene elements, you want to be pretty specific, especially on your first slug line. And sometimes I've seen writers even do, you know, present, you know, day or night. So then also, like, you know, on the first one, you usually can tell us, like, you know, is it modern day? I mean, we can tell, but it helps. Classic crime scene, officers are walking around putting up their tape. EMTs are carrying away dead bodies. Detectives are not too enthusiastic about looking for evidence because it would complicate the sound theory. Show, don't tell. So, great job, Foxy. So, it's really hard to visualize this on in a scene, right? So, how do I know that, you know, it would because it would complicate the sound theory that it was a firefight made clear by a clean dozen dead bodies? So, because that's a challenge, and especially if you've done novel writing, it's a really tough transition to get into screenplays because you can think you can express it through just telling it, but in this case, all has to be visualized. Do I visualize the theory? Let me make sure I'm not missing comments. Doing good. Halfway through my next script. Great job. Plugging away every day.
All day.
Like a boss, Majin Buu. I will.
I'm jealous.
I have your script in my queue, by the way. So, nuclear. I will.
Cut this out.
Yeah. It makes it sound really great. I just woke up. I'll just cut this line. show it's a teaser.
The start of a pilot spec.
Oh, that could be correct. Yeah, maybe so. Hence the question marks. I'm usually not as familiar with TV pilots. I used to just read features, so maybe that's my own noobness. And yeah, I'm excited to read your script as well, Majin Buu. It is in the final boss queue, so fear not, it is coming up. But yeah, my experience primarily was in feature films, so hence no such thing as teaser, but maybe it is in como dice? TV shows. There we go. It wasn't clear, however, that this location that well, what isn't clear, however, is the location of the firefight. The vague-looking interior makes it distinguish where the crime scene takes place. So vagueness in scenes, and also it's a very not, it's a still, you're still telling,
what does vague look like? Like, dim, yeah. Lit, bare walls. I'm gonna spell this out.
Yeah, is dimly it lit, hazy?
Bare gray walls.
Is it gray? Like, you know, what is it? So, like, those types of elements are really tough to visualize, and this would almost, you know, if this was a feature and I was reading this and this was like the intro, I'd be like, this kind of bodes ill because I can't visualize this, right? Like, you don't want to make the reader do the work of figuring out how to make, you know, a vague-looking interior difficult to distinguish where the crime scene takes place. It's very abstract. You want to make a concrete scene where the reader pulls the abstract out intuitively. So you never say the abstract, you always show the concrete as a writer. Morgue night. The coroner is walking down a line, putting tags on toes and sliding the corpses into their new refrigerators. So great. Very visual. I'm picking that up much clearer. He's humming Tchaikovsky's Overture. Not only is he a man of classical taste, but evidently not fazed by surrounding death. Another show-don't-tell moment. you know, you have to trust the reader because you actually do it already. You actually show me that he's not fazed.
Yeah, just that he's humming, walking through this, like, crime scene. We get, like, oh, he's used to this.
Exactly. So trust your reader. I get he's not fazed by humming. No need to say explicitly. Again, because the thing is, these are long lines, and usually in scripts, you want them under four. So, like, this shouldn't be five, especially your opening line should be punchy. You know, this is four, but think about it this way. One of, like, the best pieces of advice I got in screenplays was, oops, I just noticed I'm behind on comments. But yeah, so one of the best pieces of advice I got for describing character was do their clothing. What people wear says a lot about the character. So you've already gotten the fact that he's not fazed. So get that next level of detail in. Get something visual that tells me about the person. Here, I'm gonna scoop back up here. You need the teaser. I was just editing. I'm writing a comedy at the moment. Did you cue the rewrite of Eve or something else like I said? I think it was the other one you sent. Yeah, I have a pilot, and I was informed by the producer of Teaser X. Oh, industry standard. Huh. I thought a minor in sci-fi were a lot stronger than the other three. Yeah. So we're reading. One that we thought was shakiest logline, and then one that we. Because that was the theme.
We usually wouldn't pick this one, so we were like, maybe we'll do this 30-page
pilot to give them feedback. Yeah.
And then we picked Minder, too, just because we wanted one of those. Like, look, actually.
Pilots need Bibles. You can upload a pilot on the Black without a Bible. I'm not really sure what. Maybe you can elaborate. So this goes to show my ignorance in. My ignorance in TV. So, yeah, I was. I'm a feature man myself, but feel free to elaborate. I'd love to kind of learn more about what a Bible is, because is it like a character list, stuff like that? Anyways, let's see if the story is well told. I won't focus too much on the details, for now at least. I'll dig in later. The detective walks. The name's Car Cameron. So normally if you have you want the character's name capitalized, not the moniker. Like, just go straight to capitalizing his name. He's tired. His lack of sleep is showing. So you done with the autopsies yet? And a good evening to you too, detective. And some, not all. Do you want to be the coroner?
Yeah.
Please, let it be good news.
If your definition of good is an easy case of gang shootout, you might be out of luck.
Damn it, what is it?
Well, one of them was blown up. Didn't even need an autopsy for that one. You should probably talk to forensics. They might have figured something out.
Cameron sighs and leaves the morgue. Doesn't want another case. Another show moment. Earlier, same day. Okay, so I get... It's a good frame. Oh yeah, Bible is the bare minimum, needs character list, breakdown of all subsequent episodes. At least four episodes in a serial. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's, do you actually have an overall character arc and story arc? TV's hard.
Yeah.
I like features, at least personally, for my own writing.
A little simpler.
I'm a feature man myself. And that is whiskey.
Yes.
You can only say I'm a feature man after taking a drag of a drink of whiskey.
Or whilst taking a drag.
Whilst. I'm a feature man myself. Cheers. All these TV writers. You have to have a raspy voice. Okay. Three men are sitting quietly bored. So the intro's good, punchy, but but it's vague. But I, the reader, you know, I see a crime scene, but I don't know. What you're trying to introduce in a teaser like this is the hook.
Or the theme, right?
True. It could be any story piece that's going to pull me into the next few scenes, right? So in this case, I have this murder scene. But there's nothing unique or so strange about it except this kind of suggestion, but it's not really highlighted, of someone being blown up. Like, if someone was blown up, I should probably see this in his mansion night part and be like, holy crap, someone just got blown up. But even that, like, in a lot of modern crime stuff, is, like, not standing out super strong. Like, you're not going to be like, oh, like, that's something new. There has to be some strange twist, especially in mystery.
Stuck to the ceiling or, like...
Yeah.
Like, I watched that.
I would be like, what the hell? How did the body get stuck to the ceiling? Like, that's jacked.
I saw that from Supernatural.
Oh, really? Oh. Give me your hand.
All my ideas are stolen. You have to learn that from me.
Yeah. Well, they're good ideas. That's a great idea. Yeah, I just and that's why like Supernatural ideas. Is a big show.
Yeah.
Jeff's
a feature.
One for a pilot, one for a feature that's developed. Oh.
Developed treatment.
Ah, I see. I used to do, I would always do full feature. Whenever I was trying to sell, because I was trying to sell a feature a while back, I usually had my body's parts in the morning explodes in the morning's hook. Yeah. Exactly. So those are like the, those are the types of hooks that like, they have to be something beyond out of the ordinary. Right now, this doesn't feel beyond out of the ordinary, so I'm not really hooked into, like, the mystery. Mm-hmm. And this looks like it's going to be a how it came about type of thing,
mm-hmm.
but I don't really care as much how it came about because the outcome doesn't seem as
like,
ditchy.
It's like the first episode of Breaking Bad, which I just saw the other day, which is, like, this guy, like, driving an RV in his underwear wearing a gas mask, and, like, he ends up, like, in his white tighty-whities with the police coming, and you're like, what the hell? Like, how did he get there? And then it goes back, and it's, like, how he got there. But at that point, you're like, I want to know, like, and there's, like, two dead guys in the back, you know, and that's a hook.
Yeah.
And you're like, I want to know how he got there.
Like, holy shit, like... The opening of like that, like I mean, God, the pilot episode of Breaking Bad is a lesson,
right? Like,
that is a lesson in screenwriting.
Then you see this like mild mannered, like you know, guy teaching a math or chemistry class, and then you're like, oh, how did? And then you want to know how he goes from that, you know, so quickly to this guy driving, you know, holding a gun in his tighty whities in the middle of the desert. And I mean, I've only seen two episodes, but yeah, I was hooked. I was like, oh yeah, I want to know.
Yeah, and he's like pointing a gun at like the street, like what how did you get there?
He's after driving an RV with like a gas. Yeah, I was.
Yeah. So true.
I feel like I'm really behind on the Breaking Bad train, but.
No, but I mean, it's a lesson in screenwriting, and that's you know, it's brilliantly done, and that's not nothing for any type of writing, right? Is if you have a hook like that, you have to find out.
Mm-hmm.
You have to, like, and it's the same thing I'm trying to rethink now in my novel. It doesn't really have a strong hook. And, you know, hence the story doesn't pick up till, like, third act, second act. So those are the things that I'm like, oh, crap, like, you either have a slow burn, but do you really want that? Not really. You want something that engages people from page one because it's their time. They may as well be engaged. Three men are sitting quietly bored. They're Nathan, Costco, and Raymond. Their apartment is small and filthy. Raymond is lying on a bed mattress, which is in the living room, along with Nathan and Costco. You guys... Yeah, so then we'll take... You can be Raymond.
I want to talk about poop.
Okay, you can be Nathan.
Okay. Hey, you guys don't really talk about poop.
Why would we talk about poop? That's dumb.
Well, I mean, it feels good when you poop.
Sure, it feels good, but why would you ever talk about poop? Yeah, it feels great to take a dump and walk away. What kind of conversation would we ever have that's so twisted that brought up the good sensation where the good sensation of poop is brought up?
Weird line.
It's very long too, and you can feel how long that line is when you're saying it because it takes a while and it's clunky. So lines over 4 lines long. Invariably are clunky.
I'm just saying, it's so interesting.
How the body explodes in nanobots. Hey, Skittles, what's going on? Sorry, I'm behind the comments.
Otherwise, wake up and a musical number ensues. I like it, Richard.
I would read the next page.
Yeah, I would definitely be like,
how did that happen?
Let's find out.
Well, wasn't it the one with the little kid with the mask? Like
the
Are You My Mummy?
Are You My Mummy?
But think about that. Like, that's a phenomenal TV show.
Doctor Who, man.
And I have to know how someone has this, like, horrifying face mask and is asking for their mummy.
Yeah.
Like, those are the types of hooks that are absolutely fascinating. And if you're doing, like, a big picture type thing,
or it's... Or the opening, the first episode I showed you with Blink.
My phone and seeing the opposite should be true. It takes so much to get a TV show made. Yeah. Teasing is being incredible. Yeah, I think a lot of what you're trying to do, and this is from my friends who worked in TV, Majin Buu, is what you're trying to do with a pilot is you're just trying to use that as an instrument to be a writer on the show. So you're like, oh, look, I wrote a pilot and I wrote a spec for this other show, like for Supernatural or whatever. So that's what a lot of people will do, and they'll write a spec and a pilot, and they'll go in and try to shop themselves around and show how they can buy. One of my buddies is actually doing that right now. He's a writing assistant on a show, and he has written a few different specs and pilots, and he's trying to sell them out. But it's very challenging.
I feel like I'm in my element here. I'm like, I'm
put a Skittles cameo deal.
What's that? A Skittles cameo.
Get a movie trilogy. Nice. One day. I mean, that's the thing. Like, it's it's easy for me to talk about the right thing to do, but like, and that's why I still have a lot of sympathy for writers. I still find myself making these same mistakes. And that's because it's really hard. Like, and that's why revision is so important. That's why editing is so important. Because you go back through, you look at the facts and say, did I actually accomplish what I meant to accomplish? And then you try to think through how to make it better. Writing a book, publish a fantasy novel, or a drama pack. Nice. Do your own struggle if you read the first few chapters of the book. Nice. That'd be fun. I'll definitely check it out.
Didn't start frozen.
So you published it, has it done well? Nice.
No.
Well, congrats. I love reading other people's stuff. It's always a blast, so I'm down.
I like reading this pilot stuff because I watch more TV than this one. I'm more of a TV girl myself.
So you know the
mechanics. So I'm like, oh no, like this is what it needs.
I need this.
I don't watch as many movies, to be honest.
That's true. I'm a feature man. Did you do on your book, Majin Buu, did you do like normal publishing channels or self-publishing, and what made you kind of make your decision, or and what do you think are the pros and cons in each? So you sound like you're pretty industry savvy. I would love that. We actually, Moocher, are considering, and the feedback starts moving in the fan, that's my phone work is turning into a book. It's a cool process. It's awesome.
Hmm. Positive way
to
look at it.
Yeah, it's so nice to have someone else's perspective, I think. Because then it's so, like, sometimes it feels like you're in a swamp. And you're just like, well, how do I make this better? I think I write a radio drama. Yeah, please do. I actually wrote a radio drama a while back for fun, and I was going to produce it myself because I used to do sound design a long time ago.
I like to do voices.
And she likes to do voices. And those who only do a publishing house. Interesting. What are your opinions on each of the sides?
Feature man.
Yeah.
Yes.
Feature man myself. Man. Yeah. I think that's why publishing has its advantages, because, you know, one, it ensures professional quality. So that's like, you know, when I go shop around my novel, I'll probably be trying to do the traditional publishing route, like, you know, get an agent at first, because I trust that system to be able to help me produce a more professional work and a better product. And then also, having a distribution channel ready to go is not a bad thing either. Anyway, okay, I'm going to keep going. Sure, it feels good to talk about poop. Okay, poop conversation is good, but it's not really a strong hook, right? Seems a bit... And what I mean by self-aware is that the writer knows they're writing something clever and funny. And it's funny, like, don't get me wrong, but I think it pulls me out of the narrative because I know this is a writer, like, saying, this will be really clever, this will engage people. You want to try to really add that layer of varnish on top of these types of scenes so it's not, poop is not interesting. Like, you know, this type of, like, it's funny conflict, it's good, but... You know, it's not, it feels like it's written a little bit, if that makes sense. Excuse me. Three pause for a few seconds, not awkward silence. You know, when you clench your butt and the turtle only half comes out, and then it's the clench, it goes back in. I hate that. Why does it even do that? Nate, shut the hell up, will you? I'm just trying to break the ice. Your eyes. Swiss ring, and he picks up. Miscellaneous services. Yeah, even because I wanted to find a book the exact material used to create the pilot. Severely edit your work to fit the page constraints and agent input. Mm. Self-publishing allows you to creative control, but to be successful you need to self-promote, which many writers are not good at. Yeah.
Yeah. Marketing skills.
Yeah, it's a lot of work. Any of you guys on Wattpad? No, someone mentioned Wattpad on another stream, actually.
Yeah.
I have no... What is Wattpad? I'm going to Google it, actually. This is much easier being on Twitch, because you can actually, like, do stuff with a computer.
Oh, yeah.
Hey! And the blonde sitting beside you. I don't have my Christmas lights.
I'll take it.
Yeah. How's it going, Casey? Good to see you. We're actually learning about what Wattpad is.
Yeah.
I'm actually quite fascinated. Stories you'll love. Community of readers and writers. Oh, fascinating. I'm already hooked. This means trouble. I'm in tears. Oh!
That's cool. Wait, so...
It's like a...
Stuff or what?
Self-publishing ebook system, I think. Oh, yeah.
I shall return.
Sam's Walmart. The industry giants. Is where you can write books and post them on the website. Cool. Yeah, well, it looks fascinating, actually. I may try to... I always like to test out, in my novels at least, the novel, my first few chapters, to see if they actually rope the reader in. So, we'll see. That's actually one of the problems I'm having with mine right now, is like I need to actually build in a hook. So maybe I'll use Wattpad as that device to test it out. Or if you guys volunteer to be beta readers, I will definitely take you up on that. You've reached the miscellaneous services. Raymond and Costco don't like the name, and they show it. Nathan listens to what the caller has to say, not saying a word, and hangs up. Well, our date has got a whole lot crappier. Should I even ask who that was? It was Eddie, again. He may have a job for us. F me, I hate that kid. Yeah, he hasn't been that good to us. So... Nathan and Raymond and Costco, okay, they all are introduced here, but they seem to be big characters, and the cat. And the cat's here. Hello, Namir, yeah. But, yeah, so these characters don't stand out as individuals. Gonna be a Twitch star, Namiria. Asanara.
Oh, she's gone.
And she's over that. She's like, no.
Hell no.
They only film me if I'm paid. See you in a little bit, Skittles.
Bye.
I'm gonna direct create space for print on demand. I'll offer you a novel. Beta's completed manuscripts. Oh, sure. I'll take you up on it. Beware, Majin Buu. Kitty. Kitty.
She wasn't doing it.
Kitties fuel the internet. I think the internet is like 90% cat.
I was like, you know what?
No more shame co.
I know, right? She's
been freed at last. Her little eye problem is better now. Yeah, poor little thing.
She's hyper now.
Poor little Namiri. Now she's super hyper. We've got to get her laser pin to mellow her out.
She's been like sprinting around.
It's better than drugs. They both know what either is going to say. Shut the hell up, will you? Trying to break the ice. F your ice. Okay. So these characters are kind of blending together, right? And that's when stuff like trimming down your telling and really showing the individual aspects. So the things to consider is they all talk in a similar fashion. No one's like well-spoken versus not. Like, those are the types of surprise moments where you're like, Eddie, I believe you're being stupid again. And like, oh, like, who's this, like, British guy that's, like, you know, against all these, like, you know, swear-wordy guys, you know? Also, things that can really bring this out is clothes. Like, maybe one's, like, dressed, like, really nice. The other two are, like, really sketchy. You know, are they dressed differently? Do they speak differently? And I've been talking about this for a little bit, but I'm probably... Next time we do a little stream together, I may actually review Preston Sturges' Sullivan's Travels. It's an older film. But it's absolutely amazingly developed and structured. And his dialogue is the best dialogue probably in film history. The reason why a lot of the early script writers came from radio drama backgrounds. So they wrote a lot of radio drama, and they were able to make their characters sound so distinct. So, you know, that's one of the reasons I write radio drama for fun. Keeps adjusting his glasses and stuttering. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I'm going to actually put that in. That's like those character twitches, stutters, like it's all like, it's so critical, and it makes such a big difference, and it makes them pop off the page.
And I feel like it's one of those things that like feels cliche when you're writing it. You're like, oh, there's always like the British guy, or like the guy who's like nervous, or like is like, no cards, come on, like.
Yeah.
But when you don't have that distinction, you miss it. You're like, I just want to like have just one person that I understand. I feel like I'm. Yeah. Like, the older I get, the more I, like, want the reliability of, like, the story tropes. Like, when I read a book, like, I'm reading this book right now, and, like, even though I knew what was going to happen, it was so, like, you know, it was like, you know, at this part where they're, like, storming the castle or whatever, and I was like, oh, she should, I don't know, I just was predicting something, and then it happened, and I was so happy. I was like, I wouldn't want them to, like...
Take that away from you. Yeah. Yeah, exactly, yeah.
It's like, it may be cliche, but it's still, like... It's still, like, unique enough, depending on the story, you know, that you want that. You want it to be, like, he's gonna, you know, have this horrible moment where everything goes wrong, and then just like, the Blake Snyder stuff.
It's he so wants the reliable. Same but different. It's you so want the reliable. Same but different, yeah.
You want, like, you know, the misunderstanding with the love interest, and or, you know, whatever, and then, you know, yeah. I won't go on too much, but, yeah.
It's true, though. I mean, that's why archetypes exist, right? Like, there are these universal things people feel, you know, that truly are universal. And and if you can find a new turn on one of those archetypes, on this, like, those moments, and there are nerdy people for all of time. And there are, you know, the cool, like, badass guys for all of time. And I think those archetypes are good, but, you know, and you're right. And it's just like, you want that same archetype, but a little bit of newness to just make it spicy.
Or even if, like, you have some of the archetypes the same and, like, one a little different, like, you're still going to appreciate those cliche archetypes that aren't that different, as long as there's, like, one. Yeah, that's a little different.
Yeah, and then, you know, you give them characteristics. And, you know, one of the great, actually, the Double Fine documentary on how they made, Broken Age. How they made Broken Age. He talks a lot about how he tries to find some characteristics that are in dissonance with the character. So it's like, it's a very fun thing to think about, and it doesn't look like these characters have been given that level of attention, right? Like, I don't see here that the writer is asked, how are these people different? How are they unique? I'm going to write a character sheet on every single one of them. Every single one. Do the work. It's worth it. And it pays off. I've done it for mine. You can look at my Evernote. It has a sheet of every single character and every single characteristic. And, you know, it's not necessarily ever going to get used in the novel, but you, the writer, have to know these people. And that doesn't seem like that's happening here. As much, yeah. Vampire Masquerade the Moocher. Awesome. Oops. There are tons of radio dramas listened to on Archive. Ooh. Yeah. I actually love... There's actually some really good contemporary radio dramas that you can find as well that are a lot of fun. The great thing is, if you love dramatic storytelling, they're really cheap and easy to produce. Mm. You can do them for like $30. Like, it's cheap. Reading Vampire RPG, got one of the king of your meticulous plan, but always needs to improvise if needed. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool. I think so, actually. Try to embrace them, a bit of fun.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I got, he sent over some awesome script stuff.
Oh, cool.
Thank you.
Who did?
I think this is, Majin Buu, I believe. Yeah, mm-hmm. Evolution's Eve. Nice. Thank you. I will star this. It's going to go into my starred email queue. Death Star stuff.
Yeah.
Sweet. I'm excited. Well, yeah, I'm going to be probably writing them, doing a outline of everything, so I'm going to be writing it soon. Ooh, Werewolf Games and Werewolf. Nice. I do love fantasy sci-fi, especially when it's done well. So I'm excited. My heart's beating a little bit. I'm excited. Slow me down, guys. All right. Well, our day just got a whole lot crappier. Okay, I'm gonna crank on this edit here, and I will check the comments soon.
Focus too.
Miscellaneous. Okay, F me, I hate that kid. It was Ethan, and he may have a job for us. F me, I hate that kid. Yes, he hadn't been that good to us. We still haven't forgotten what you used to about you using that name. We both vetoed, so it stays dead. Missile fucking Aeneas? Jesus, man. Just get dressed. We got a job to try. They get out their asses, ready to get up. Act 1. Okay. Car moving day. Nate, Costco, and Ray are clipping their large bagels and drinking their to-go cups of coffee. This might as well be your average commute to work. Another kind of telling moment. Something to be aware of. Someone's doing donuts out there. Good old Vallejo, right? You showed the commute feel. Trust the reader. Don't tell what you just showed. So, Eddie, what are you doing here? What are we doing here? So, I'll tell you what we're doing here. Hey, Pearson, how's it going? Fudge RPG game is a good character building, too. I actually really like Fate. So Fate uses some really good character devices as well. Sweet. Really did a very strong job in transforming it into a pun. Nice. Love it.
I'm excited.
I think they are criminals. The log line kind yes. of hinted at that.
Indeed they are. Indeed they are. Novels are tricky, but as long as you have the tone fairly quickly, you have some time. Game stayed in the first 500 words. Yeah. That Blake Snyder. They know. They want that theme. He just said that he had a job for us. That would be easy. That is it? I think it's a guard job. Guard job. Does he have an array of henchmen to choose from? I'm sure it'll be fine. You've never been sure of anything that's true. Hey, man, let me concentrate on driving here. Fine. Be like that. They stopped talking for a second. Nathan's the only one who still hadn't finished his food. So a lot of no conflict. So, and it's play conflict. I know. A long time, buddy. Final boss has been getting worked pretty hard at his day job, sadly. Gotta tell my manager to mellow out.
Just give him a lobotomy.
Yeah. Just keep him on the editing. Not much conflict in these scenes. Not real conflict. So, and this is actually really interesting when you think about conflict. Because you can get away with, like, the bantery, like, screw you, man, you're dumb, screw you, for, like, one scene. But after that, the reader is going to want real stakes. And stakes is the difference between good conflict and fluff conflict. Because if there's nothing that gets lost, if something goes wrong, if you don't lose something, or the writer doesn't like pay, or the reader to, or the character doesn't pay a price for it, then it's not real conflict. Got to have stakes for real conflict. All right. Let me see. I'm gonna check the notes. Fix the conflict to affect the setting and mood. It's true. And then drawing in a scene, stuff like that. Yeah, absolutely. I don't know how to do a thumbs up, but I'll do like a plus one. I'll do the Google. Curse me for being a Google Plus guy.
Yeah, I just got an email from Google Plus. Like, do you know Joker? I was like,
yes,
but I'm not going to.
There are no vegetarian conflicts. That's true. I think that's true. These are vegetarian conflicts.
Man, I just got hungry.
Why did we start helping people for a change? And say, I agree. The next thing you have to say, annex in the local soup kitchen. Plus one. Exactly. It would at least be surprising. Because one thing is, when you don't have a big conflict and you don't have a really strong, distinct hook, this is so far on page 5 going to what the reader expects. You never want that to happen. And it's not because, like, I'm like, oh, criminals, like, the criminals are doing what I expect criminals to do. give me a criminal that is, like, really nice or, like, going to the food kitchen, right? And that's mm-hmm. the challenge with mm-hmm. with more if you – sometimes you can tell if someone hasn't done their research because the more you dig into a character, the more those distinct special things about that character that makes them surprising and unique come out. So those character sheets pay dividends, guys. It really works. I don't know. What are you secretly not listening to? They call what's over. So far, you haven't been sure about anything you said. It's been something about, I think, so far. Just wasn't really paying too much attention. Dumbass. Quietly drink their coffees. Conversation's over. Docs are emptied out by their illegitimate criminal bosses, making it a perfect place for a meeting. Again, show don't tell. I'm not going to put that note in, but you may want to do a pass on that, the writer later. The groups have been wearing suits and standing opposite to the side of the car. They're gangs. Interior car day. I really hate this, you know? So do I, but we got to pay the rent somehow. But we own our house. We don't pay rent. It's figure of speech, a-hole. Means we need the money. What for? For goods and services, for sustenance. Christ, man. Haven't you stayed alive all these years? Not really a materialist, so good for you, Buddha. Then why is he in the business? Is he just because his friends are? That seems like a very unmotivated character. So these characters, one, sound alike, and it's tough when you've introduced a lot of characters. I mean, because this isn't like the worst case I've seen, but you had two detectives and a coroner and three friends, and somebody is calling him on the phone. So you're at about a character a page right now, which is like seven characters, seven pages. I think there was one more. So it's plus one. So it's a little bit risky, right? So the reader, there is not a clear protagonist right now. It just feels like this blur, and maybe this team of protagonists, which is really, you can pull it off. But your level of skill and technique has to be beyond mine and beyond a lot of people I know. You have to be like top 1% of the top 1%. That's like a top 0.001%. So you have to be real good to pull off multi-protagonist story. And I'm not there yet. And I don't know if this is there yet either. So you're beginning to see that toll starting to happen. And the story is starting to kind of lose its focus because of that. So it's tough. Characters sound alike. What else? There is no. There are a lot of characters, and no one stands out as prot. Equals bad. Which is ironic because in your log line you actually said it's about a protagonist, and you actually use that word protagonist. But there isn't a protagonist.
This is the protagonists.
The protagonists. Ooh.
Yeah,
there's your problem. Multiple protagonists are extremely challenging to pull off. Daenerys separated from Westeros. Yeah.
Even that's tough.
But also George R.R. Martin is a master. A master of story structure. Like, I have never read, and I've read a lot of stuff, I've never read a more structure-driven story than, and like, it is damn near perfect, than Game of Thrones, because it is so precise.
Like 10 years to write a book.
But he's plotted it out perfectly, yeah. And he's an absolutely phenomenal structure writer. Give a sound a lot like Twin. And by emotion and passion. And having them be really distinct, right? Because Daenerys is a lot different from Jon Snow. Mm-hmm. And these characters all sound exactly alike. So you get this blur effect, which unfortunately serves as dilution. So it dilutes the impact that each character has, as opposed to when you have distinct, strong characters, it like is additive. No, but he's a master. Like, that guy must plot. Like, how he plots that out must be extremely time-consuming, which is probably evidenced by the fact that he, like, takes years to write a book. But all the characters are also very distinct. Why the hell not? Okay, blah, blah, blah. I said I was sorry. Sorry is not enough. I guess that leaves me to charge the grenade. It's not yours either. You used it. I didn't use it. I was shot. You shot it. Point you. I'm taking the grenade this time. Three men stand at the exit of the car. Ooh, it's a long line of dialogue. The car engine is left. The three men have exited the car without locking the doors.
Okay, can I do it?
Yeah, you can do the voiceover.
See that kid in the suit right there? That's Eddie. Eddie Draconi. He's the son of Jonathan Draconi, head of the Draconi crime family, in charge of every single aspect of organized crime in Oregon and Idaho, except for anything related to narcotics and theft. Now, it's smart to ask why his son would be in a small place like Eugene. Well, it's the only place small enough that would put up with his bullshit. If you haven't noticed, he's the smallest and most annoying guy here. The only reason he wasn't shot to death years ago is that his father would summon a fiery rain of death and destruction upon the killer and his family. The fact that he's 19 isn't the only reason a prostitute hurls after he's done with her. The guys on the far end of the docks are Spanish. I couldn't pronounce their boss's name if I tried. They handle the narcotics and theft in Oregon and Idaho. What's happening while he's talking?
Great question. So you're absolutely right. So this definitely needs, should I get some rest?
Hello. Or bye, I mean.
Bye, Nick. Thanks for tuning in again. So I think, yeah, you're absolutely right. So usually when you're dealing with something like this, an intro scene like this, there's a few things that you should keep in mind. One is this is a very cliche moment. This is something we see a lot. Two, a long line of dialogue like this, you want to break it up with action. Make the action zoom us in to those people. Like, maybe they're smoking a cigarette and, like, you know, a long-haired guy. Because all these names are free-floating. I do not have faces to attach to these names.
Mm-hmm.
And then three...
Have there been any descriptions of them?
Yeah, no, I don't think so. Maybe there have, but they haven't been specific enough. So I'll do P7. I'll just do this, I'll kind of bullet this. The intro is a cliche moment. Beware. Break this dialogue up with action or character description. Seeing my Coney, because I like dressing files. See what I did there? It's true, but I bet you if you read the Godfather screenplay, you'll probably see it broken up. And also, the Godfather, yeah, so you'll see action lines between here, right? Like, you'd see, like, a cut to, like, this family, a cut to this family. So the fact that he's doing this on the page is a bit of a misstep, but also... the risk is the Godfather is the reason it's cliche is because they did it right. And, you know, freaking they did it right the first time. So now the fact that they established that precedent means that other writers will have to try to reinvent that trope because they nailed it. That's why the trope exists. So it always comes off as cliche when you do a moment like this. Yeah. Yeah, only broken up, I think he can barely speak. He's with me now. If anybody's a long dialogue, they need to have an amazing voice.
Like, yeah, and things need to be saying, going on. Like, nobody wants to just sit and hear a voice.
Or saying, I am Groot.
Yeah.
yeah, which is true. But also, these types of mafia, and that's the thing, like, the thing that I think is going to really also hurt this screenplay is it's playing to every single trope and it's delivering as expected. So the problem is this is a trope of crime. The bantering bad guys is a trope of crime. You know, the horrible murder scene in the beginning is a trope of crime. All these have been done and they've been done exactly as expected by the reader. So me, the reader, I know they're going to get some kind of bad job. I know it's going to go wrong. I know there's going to be some gunfights. But I am worried that he's not going to deliver as expected, or he's going to deliver exactly as expected. He's not going to surprise me as the reader. And I, the reader, I want surprise. This story plays a lot Okay, still waiting by the car. Spanish man halfway about to cross the docks. Start walking towards them. Why are they? Oh, there's more.
Oh my gosh.
You ready? So this one's a bit overdone.
Why are they talking something out, you ask? Why didn't one of them kill the other and take over the whole organization here? Why would they ever respect each other's roles in the crime organization here and not compete with each other? Well, they're both working under the same kingpin of crime, a man with enough power and money to keep organized crime well organized. What's his real name? What does he look like? Where does he live? Does he have a family? I don't know. I don't want to know. No one knows. Times two.
Whoa, whoa, whoa! Who invited these guys? What the hell's wrong with you, Draconi?
In case you don't know what our job is, we're the guys you call when a hitman refuses to do a ridiculous job. We're the guys you call when your getaway driver can't pimp out a hot dog van and use it as an escape vehicle. When your low IQ henchmen keep getting killed in the stupidest ways possible. When a job involves a fetish that you don't want your men to know of. We get called when someone wants us to do miscellaneous jobs. Random tasks that there isn't a job title for. As to why this senor is angry, well, we've gained a reputation for jumping the gun, resorting to the nuclear solution, if you will.
Oh, they said it! Like a boss! Okay, so I actually like this. I wish it was established earlier.
Exactly. I was going to say, if it was earlier, I think it would have been better. Why not open with that? Why not open with that while they're at the crime scene or something?
Yeah.
Jump back or something. Or I don't know.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I think you're really hitting the nail on the head, right? Because there's a lot of fluff in the beginning. And it's not like a bad thing. It's just, you know, hey, like, I have a lot of fluff in my story. I have to cut it all out. Night, Moocher.
Night, Mooch.
Georgia flag and whistle Dixie a few times. Have a good one, buddy. Plus one. Your character would work, yeah.
I'm Dixie.
It's just an experience made on a long winded speech that gravitas, yeah.
Dixie.
Sleep well, Moocher. Pro move. Yeah. It would be a lot stronger. I think a lot of it is... It's tricky. I think this is a guy who likes crime films. I actually like his premise of the nuclear solution, guys. But, you know, I would really drill down to one protagonist who's, like, the leader of them or whatever. Or maybe he's the guy on the bottom that's trying to get to the top of the nuclear guys.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would, you know, really start trimming a lot of this extra stuff and then find a way to turn these tropes on their heads. Foxy with that southern lullaby. She's a pro.
Away way down south of Dixie.
She's a
Civil War reenactor.
She was.
And I was a southern girl, so I know my southern twos.
Like boss. Night, Moocher. In case you don't know what our job is, okay, that was good. Easy buddy there with me, just insurance. Insurance, I thought we were here to talk, and are. And here is bystanders with an objective perspective. Think of them as your friend's wife. Yeah, whatever. Hey, don't look at me, I don't know why we're here. We're here because one of Draconi's guys is selling meth, taking customers away from us. He wasn't our guy, he was independent. Oh yeah, I guess he just googled how to sell meth and got past the NSA and went out and bought all tools. And did it on his own overnight. Look, man, I don't know why he was selling that stuff. All I know is we don't know him. And we're here very sorry. I think it'll never happen again. A whole lot of things we don't know him. I was just, you know, being friendly. You know what I think? I think you're lying, Spaniard. Sorry. Spanish gang pulled out their pistols, holding it by their waist. I really don't think this is necessary, guys. Trio pull out their 22s, aim at the head of the Spanish speaker. 22s. Seems like a little bit pansy guns. It's a pretty low caliber.
They told me that
about a
38. I should use a 22.
Well, they are obviously assuming you're a pansy.
I'm not.
I'm just kidding.
Clearly, it would get me.
22s are fine. They're just more... Like, I've only... Yeah, they're not going to pack much of a punch. They're just little tiny 22s. Why not 38s? Pulled out my gun. Hit you with a 38. You know that one? I'm in love with the coco. Tropes in reverse, then. Yes, that's correct. Yeah. Then the readers are right. I think that's a lot of the problem with some of the stuff we've read on SS a few times, is like it's usually like very delivered as expected. Seriously, this is unnecessary. I'm telling you what's unnecessary. Telling Meth about these parts has an agreement a long time ago. It's way too late to start stirring S up. You're the one pointing a gun at me. You're the one stirring S up. How about you bullshit up and talk about it? It's your word against his. Now let's check the facts, senor. Oh, not the Spaniard. Some of you have a supposed freelancer Meth on you? Yeah, I do. Spanish reaches in the back pocket. Discharge of a farmer's hermit's Costco. He shot the Spaniard in the throat. The dying Spaniard fires his gun, but is an inability to aim. One of Eddie's men drag him out towards the car. After the Spaniards have killed the two remaining draconian henchmen, they run away. Oh, I don't know why that just escalated so quickly. For no reason. Okay. Well, I think I'm going to be calling this one at page 10. This was a post of Bernie. So excited. My book was put on the long list for award by readers. Great job!
Oh, nice. Can we vote for you?
Sometime? Yeah, how do we vote? And also, I remember you said your book was written in Danish, so that's a bummer.
Dutch website. Dutch.
Yeah. Or Dutch, sorry.
Too bad I'm Danish. Awkward. Just kidding.
The Dutch.
Dutch is cool too.
Well done. That's awesome. Congratulations. Super. That's terrific.
Super cool.
Yeah. Well, hard work pays off. Great job. Mm-hmm. Well, nuclear solution. Let's go ahead and write the overalls. Yeah. I liked your short story though. Okay, so good, fun action, good writing, improve, beware the trope, don't deliver as expected. Oh, actually, try movies with unexpected, and then also I really liked the concept of the nuclear guys.
God, you say nuclear one more time.
Nuclear. Don't kill me. Well, keep up the good work, and if you ever write a book in English, or you get your Dutch book translated, let me know. I unfortunately am a little bit inexperienced in Dutch language proficiency, yeah. So it's a bummer.
Danish. Yeah,
you elsker dig. What's that mean?
I love you.
Aww. Adorable. Oh, wow. Okay.
Are you embarrassed now?
No, it's cute. Come here. She's adorable.
I can say Vahildudu.
What's that mean? All right, you don't remember.
I think it's... Who are you or what's your name? I don't know.
Look at my competition. That's awesome. Trying to get in the short list. That's your goal? Well, good job. That's pretty awesome. Well done. Beware the trope. I actually have to beware the trope in my novel as well. And then let me think. Get a single protagonist. These guys sound alike, and I don't resonate with any of them. And then, what was the other big note? Show, don't tell was a big one. And beware of long dialogue. I think that was the big stuff. Yeah. Cool. All right. Well, that's nuclear solution. And then now it's Minder is up next. Let's see what happens. Dun, dun, dun. Off we go, embarking.
So are you okay with the thing on the front?
I'm not. I've already made my opinions clear. yeah, beware of the... I mean, it's cool, but... I'm not a big fan of cover art.
What do you see in it?
I see... the continents of the world.
I see a face.
How do you see a face?
Two eyes, nose, tusks.
Tusks. A lot of faces have tusks in your land. Yeah, is that so? Is that so, young lady? All right. Ooh. Okay. But the script has to have a single protagonist with the TV being so focused on character. Yeah.
Like Lost, for instance.
Oh, that was the other one, the irony. That's right. Give me... I think that was Deliver on Trope, so I guess that's included. That's true. Mm-hmm. I would think that in this one, Majin Buu, I normally would agree with you that you don't have to have one protagonist, but I would say that if you're an amateur writer and you're, you know, you're working on just the basics of the craft, and I don't know, maybe this guy's beyond that level, but that's where my intuition tells me this person is. If you're an amateur writer, every big major character you add is a layer of complexity in exponents. It's an exponential layer of complexity, and it's something that I would be really, really cautious writers to do, and I avoid it like the plague in my writing because I know I'm not like a badass, so I don't do it because I know I can't pull it off, or it'll be really hard for me to pull it off. So yeah, I would just be very scared about that. Mm-hmm. Best procedural character ever, but the irony for Columbo isn't the character, it's a trope, procedural itself. None that kill her before Columbo does. Yeah, it's the reverse of the trope. Huh. So it's just using dramatic irony. I actually never watched Columbo. Shame on me. I need to, though. I heard it was good. Anyways. Minder. You can pull up the log line and read it. I'll do it later. Alright, we open on a line of dog paws. Aww. Urban beach morning. We open on a line of dog paw prints in the sand. Those impressions like a psychologist's ink blots, one after the other. A wave spills over them. Dirty foam sates their indentations. The sand sinks, flattens around them, and early morning sunlight glistens like magic, and like that, the prints are gone. Mysterious man, voiceover. It can happen gradually or quickly. Those benchmarks we take for granted. The horizon, loved ones, those who no longer become distinguishable to the mind. Pretty eyes squint. A radiant sunrise. Thera, the morning. She's equally radiant. Puzzlement. Always in those eyes. However, always trying to arrange the thoughts like holding onto the note cards. And just... That was a little confusing. Uh-oh. Yeah. Hey, what's up, Ken's Party House? How's it going? That worth watching? Everyone tells me I should watch The Wire. I think you can do it, final. Thank you, Bookfish. I just want to... finish off one that's good with a single protagonist, and then I'll get crazy later. Threya, this morning. She's equally radiant. Puzzlement, always in those eyes. However, always trying to arrange her thoughts, like holding to those note cards in a speech. Her, okay, so typo there. Yeah. Or it's so a spacing fun. Error. Page one. Spacing error. Also, note cards hard to visualize. Show something. I mean, I get the sense you can use that like for casting and to have a character, and maybe it's an actor cue, and you can kind of get away with that, but still is a little bit tenuous of a stretch. Also, it's and we'll see. It's different writing styles, so we'll see if it works or not. A radiant sunrise. Thera, this morning. She's equally radiant. Puzzlement, always in those eyes. However, always trying to arrange her thoughts, like holding to those note cards in a speech. Her cell phone, one way to capture her thoughts. Snap, there's a picture. Takes a picture with it. She brings the phone down, shades the screen from the sun to jump, judge the shot. A bump, something impacts her legs. A flash of black, something solid. She moves aside, startled. Hell, what was that? A Labrador dog trolls past her. The dog seems to measure its steps. Its head bobs up and down as though following a jumping bean. It falters on...
The apostrophe B on the other side.
Where are you looking?
Oh, never mind. You're right. It's... Never
mind. Oh, they she doesn't even need... She doesn't need an apostrophe at all. She should just take that out. Oh, there I have come from a sacred realm. This is the realm of lust and greed. It's a bit unfair. What's up, Tolmite? It's sounds like an interesting realm.
Yeah.
Is it the realm of a Labrador dog on a screenplay? Because on an urban beach in the morning? Is this the dog? Is it the Labrador talking to us? Something is plainly off in this dog sniffs. Are you okay?
Oh, yeah, I'm just yawning.
Thera steps back, eyes registering some anxiety. Large dogs in general leave her apprehensive. This one without a plane. Show. Well, I guess... You don't have to tell us. So trust the reader. This is a trust the reader. Page one. Trust the reader. Just showing is enough. Overstating something you already showed us. That's page two, but whatever.
I don't understand this line.
What? Okay, steps back. Large dogs in general off screen. This one without a plan. It's cancer, that confusion that clings to that mask.
What?
My husband's taking her to be put down.
What? She's saying, oh, the dog has cancer? Is that what she's saying?
Maybe.
Why is she saying, what?
There are turns. Yeah, cancer line is pretty weird. And it adds to an overly poetic feel that's beginning to build. Yeah, so it already seems like it's, like, trying to be this, like, big, like, floaty, massive, abstract thing, and, like, it's already kind of, like, losing its track a little bit. It's Bubbles, the MJ Bioptic. Yeah, not necessarily, but this is a... It's a Triumphs. You still only watch movies alone, her only side. Feelings for her. Yeah. We get our internal failures and triumphs. Are you a screenplay reader now, Dolomito, or a Labrador dog with cancer? We may never know. Find out next week. The cat, or a cat named Nymeria, who is staring confused at us right now. The voice from a middle female dog owner. The woman's eyes wide, obviously swollen from crying. She looks with an aching heart at her dog. My husband's taking her to be put down when we get home. Not so very scary now, but it's still a distance is kept just to be on the safe side. The owner approaches the dog, kneels beside her. She gently strokes a coat of thin hair, brunt veins. She loved the beach and Iwata since she was a puppy. Haven't you, sweetheart? So weird. Creepiest female dog owner ever. Right? I get the sense... no normal people talk like this. Get it's part of your tone, but it strains believability. Do you see the cancer in it, child? It's like, she's no, I'm scared.
Ever since she was a puppy, haven't you, sweetheart? Yes.
Emiria. Later, Bookfish.
Bye.
Maybe one of those avian ancestors. Wow, bye. What? All right, don't let me tell. It's been real. It's been fun. How do I actually... I used to remember to do this whole... Oh, no. Alright, well, too lazy. There we go. And... beep. GG. GG, no re. Anyways, okay. Gently strokes her thin hair.
Yeah, he had to go.
Gave it a shot. YOLO. It was well written, though. Yeah, we should have edited it.
Yeah.
I can unban him if you guys want to edit his story as well.
Good memory. I don't know how you remember that monologue.
It's Majin Buu. He's a pro. Just be careful. He's already... it depends on if Majin Buu's already eaten Android, you know, Android 18, right?
I mean, I could give you a monologue from The Lion King, no problem, but...
yeah.
Jurassic Park.
Remember you seeing the beach bag on your shoulder, pulls out a rubber ball, always play to a fault. Don't ban, it's not distracting. Alright, I can unban it. I don't know how to do... oh, I don't care. As long as you guys are having fun. Oh, I don't think I can. Oh, well. Whoops. Sorry, Dolomito, if you're still on. Oh, Twitch has a Battle.net account. Nice. We'll have to play some Heroes of the Storm. Hotspur? I'm always playful to a fault. She rubs it under the ball's nose. Suddenly the woman brings her arm back. She tosses the ball to the sea as far as it can go. The dog jettisons off the sand. Into the waves, she splashes. You could describe it as a jubilant and playful. This dog has awoken. There, a surprise, turns to watch a sudden burst of life. The dog swims, almost a smile on its face. The dog owner behind her, wretched sob. My husband never liked dogs, but for some reason she wouldn't get in the car with me. Breaks, gasps in her mouth, turns it a rotation to mini. And the dog paddle. The dog is swimming out to sea, on shore. She's swimming the wrong way. She looks back at her dog's owner. You need to do something. The woman collapses and sogs and shakes her head and now she's deaf. She wouldn't hear you even if she called. The dog swims further out. Time is crucial here. She turns back to the woman, now crouched, crumpled in the sand. Bit of stubbornness streak, but all dogs have one down there. Who is this female dog owner? You're the creepiest person alive. Scares me. It's nice. I've ever seen my Terraria server in some NES blind speedruns. Ooh, she's gonna try to do the Foxy Lady 17. Lady. What's it again?
The Foxy Lady 17.
Foxy Lady.
The Foxy Lady.
17. She's gonna be doing some Ori the Blind Forest.
I played it a while. No, not in the speedrun. like 5 hours.
Takes a 5 hour speed run, guys. It's going to be a medium speed run.
But it took me 20 hours the first time I played, so.
It's true. Worth. Thera stands furiously, her breath ragged, okay, she dives in to get the gog. Whistle the dog. Okay. Good save the dog moment. But a bit confusing with the writing style. It just kind of seems like all over the place and a little bit blurry. Having hard time kind of visualizing really like what's happening as much. So yeah, I would try to make this a little bit more concrete here. That Insta, though.
Did so you get the money?
Yeah, a bunch.
Called it.
Moments later, the shore. I don't know how to do this.
There's comments.
There you go.
Yeah, look.
Oh, it's
best
Randall.
IG out there.
That's one of my coworkers.
Oh.
Moments later, the shore of welcome relief. She stumbles on the surf in the sand, collapses on her back. The dog owner is gone now. She raises her hand. Nothing. Then a sudden realization. No. Sighs. Hand her pocket. Her cell phone is destroyed. Tosses her phone. It's back with foodstuffs. Like a boss. Ramen. Plus. Oh, it is in early February. No! Hang in there, bookfish. The mysterious man, 40, carries himself with some weight, some gravity, bends down. He retrieves Thera's cell phone from the span, spots her out of shouting distance. She trudges dejectedly into the beach toward home. There's a chance, however, slight, by there, that she gets back somehow. I want to believe that. Title card.
Minder.
Yeah. She retrieves Thera's cell from the sand. Dog's plaything discarded ashore with nothing more. I'm at 9 in the morning. Breakfast of champions. Oh, nice. Carries himself with some weight, some gravity, bends down. Yeah, it seems kind of vague. The action is getting a little bit blurry here. Teresa pulls a stubborn old kitchen drawer. It's stuck. Pull, voicing strain there. She grabs a steak knife from the door, sticks it in her pocket, handle at the ready. Sister, modest apartment, sofa, easy chair. It's not much, however. You should. Then hurries down, leaves coming down. Okay, murky light fills the ceilings, drab ceilings, despite the walls to fight it. It's an old building with a few vintage touches to draw the romantic. Rain beats against a few windows along the wall, making the place seem more dour than it already is. Rain beats against the cave. Thera makes her way down the hall in her apartment, knocks the door, knocks, door opens. Alex opens up in a wife beater, something is always gnawing at him. Something always needs fixing. I have no idea how to visualize it. Yeah, that one's a bit odd. I would say page 7, Alex, description. Can we show this? Telling us about him seems off. Can't visualize how this would look on screen. We ask cookies. That'd be fun. I'm in. Here, I'll do the Shazam. Now we'll find out. And pirate hats. That's awesome. guess that is the pirate one, huh? You can find the K. Alex comes in. He looks like a messed up boyfriend. This guy's downstairs. You're my backup, Alex, okay? In case it's just some bogus story of his to rape me? Well, let's see. To find you, he had to get your phone to work, right? So his intention is probably just that, to return your phone to you. Teresa rolls her eyes. You can find stuff on anyone these days if you look hard enough. Always the knight in shining armor on the battlefield, but never allowed entry into the royal palace. Alex, come on, hurry up. He backs up and disappears. That's what microwaves are for. Thera leans her back against the wall to wait for him. Pouring rain outside thunders in this dark, cavernous space. Apartment building lobby is cavernous. I would almost be aware that kind of being so poetic is a bit distracting. I've never experienced a cavernous.
Yeah. Granted, I'm kind of half paying attention, but like now I'm just reading.
No,
this.
I'm full paying attention. And it's a bit.
Mother Nature.
Oh, I think it's like this mosaic. That's also, is this a necessary detail?
Oh, yeah. Maybe that's it. I was like, what?
What? Seems a bit random. And confusing. That's the thing, like these detailing elements, you always want to make trying to follow watching. Swear as piracy curses that internet. Yeah, it's all good. I know a lot of the writers don't use the camera. I think we're the only weirdos that camera in. But you know, we didn't have much experience, yeah. Indubitably. No, leave me hanging. Sorry. Okay. Just kidding. But yeah, it's more fun when you're editing screenplays to be able to perform it, I guess. Pouring rain outside, thunders in the dark, cavernous spaces, the sound of tapping, glints mosaic tire. So I guess it's supposed to be the tiles, like the lightning flashes, and then you see like the tile.
Mm-hmm.
The rain soaked window, the glow of a taxi roof night. Mysterious man awaits, sloshed in rain tote. So it's good. Good mystery. Adding mystery is good. But it's a bit telly that he's named Mysterious. Let me come to the conclusion as the reader that he's Mysterious. Like, if you name him Mysterious, is it that one screen? I camera away all the time. Like, good. It's us both. Rock on, Bookfish. It's camera twitch people going strong.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'd be aware using names like Mysterious Man, stuff like that. Try to just be that next level. If you there's something a little bit more specific, like Cloaked Man, like something about the character, because that's like a more abstract. The more abstract your writing gets, the harder it is for the reader to visualize. You're making them do the work of turning it into a picture and movie in their mind. Thera and Agnes arrive at the dingy elevator. Elevator lights up above them, sputters. The seawater did some number on my hair. I look okay. Is that some jealousy in those eyes? You stumble upon your phone, Thera, not your personal ad. Pokes a finger at Alex's mound of chest. Spaghetti sauce is soaking through your pecs. They saying. Should I go back and get my shirt on? No, I'm just pumping you up for the fight in case, you know, you up for it. Not everyone in the world will take advantage of you. There are some nice people out there in the world. It's a bit telly. So dialogue is like, don't forget, you should trust people. This is something to be aware of, and it's why conflict helps dialogue a lot. So the fact that you don't have conflict in this scene makes the fact that you're delivering you have to get exposition across, but it makes the fact that you're just delivering exposition really obvious.
So why doesn't that qualify as like arguing? Is that just not conflict enough?
But it's like the fluff conflict. It's you know. asking Tilly. Because it's, you know, there's nothing at stake. They're just like, you know, she's like, you're boxing pecs. Ha ha ha. Spaghetti's soaking through your pecs. Should I go and back get my shirt on? No, I'm just pumping you up for a fight in case, you know, you up for it. I don't really know what that means. And everyone in the world is out to take some advantage of you. They seem to work in shadows, don't they? I've got a few grand. It's also not super, like, it's like a little bit disjointed, I think. Mm-hmm. It's like a little bit like meh, meh, like weird stuff.
Yeah.
You got a few grains, yeah. I don't know. Feels disjointed. I actually don't know what I think is the better out of these two yet. Actually almost am down for nuclear.
This one's strange.
Yeah. I thought this was gonna be really strong. Weird. That's your mini tries.
Oh, his silent Willow.
Stuff that in your pirate book. Internet curses you.
Silent Willow's here.
Nice. Oh, hey, Willow. Where is Silent Willow? Hey, boss. Oh,
lady,
hey.
My lady boss.
Lady boss. Yay. The boss princess. Sorry, Silent Willow. Didn't notice. Oh, wow. There's a lot of stuff that can happen. Sorry, I was... Okay, it's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
How is he mysterious? What makes him mysterious? Mm-hmm. You mean that? Yeah. Very true. It's both really... I'm a little nervous because it shows people insane. Nice. Well, it's good. That's how everybody gets better, is you, I mean, I've streamed some bits of my novel, and my novel's not really good yet, so I'm very okay with admitting that, and with time and effort and lots of work, I think it will get better. But, yeah, I love talking through process. I think that's how... I love reading great stories, and it's a good opportunity for me. Just come out of my sulky corner then. Yay!
Yay.
But, you know, I love reading great stories. So I think the more I can share the things that I've learned that maybe will help versus the other one. Yeah, thanks for the follow, Majin Buu. You can see Fox's...
I haven't streamed anything.
Her mad streams. She's going to, yeah, give Foxy Lady the follow, and she'll... She's going to do some Ori and the Blind for us, I think.
At some point, after exams.
The mysterious man straightens, turns the elevator open, then Therese and Alex exit. Tara? She nods and approaches. He hands over the cell phone. I know a day without mine, and I'm seriously lost. I need it to remind me of practically everything. Thank you, really, thank you. What doesn't your phone remind you? What?
And of what doesn't your phone remind you to do or of?
Yeah. Alex nods his head. Good answer. To listen more?
What? That wouldn't be my response to that.
Yeah, I think this is the challenge where it's like, beware the abstract big idea stuff. And there's actually a really funny, because it's actually in the more recent book of Blake Snyder, The Snave the Cat Strikes Back. I'm not 100% proponent of his stuff, but he is very insightful on a few of the challenges in writing. And one of the things he calls it is when a writer gets so infatuated with their own work and poeticism that they lose track of the story. And he calls it the sun coming up and the smell of the road on the beach.
The smell of dust and rain on the road in the morning.
Yeah, the smell of the dust and the rain on the morning at dawn. Yeah. The smell of dust and rain on the road at dawn. Yeah, so that's like what Blake Snyder would say.
We're smoking stuff? We're always smoking stuff.
In the Netherlands? So yeah, so these, like, it's sometimes clear when a writer gets a little bit too infatuated with the sound of what they're... And it's not necessarily a bad thing. Like, you gotta love what you write. But I think you sometimes lose that critical eye where it's like, hey, is this making sense? Is this clicking when that happens? She reaches in the pocket, pulls out I got my phone back. She takes the phone over her head in triumph. Then she spots the taxi waiting outside. Oh, God, I need to take a taxi here. Starts to pull out the knife. Oops, wrong pocket. From the other pocket, she holds a $20 bill. She holds it out to the man. Please, for your trouble. No, I can't. Nearby beach combo. Hair dryer. Nothing long and arduous. What? I'm on my way to the office. There, notice expensive shoes cut off on his pants. This is no beggar. And that's when we got to do the Heimlich maneuver on Final Boss editing. Purple prose, yeah. Oh, it's like triplicating my mouse. Look at that.
Whoa.
Ooh. So
nice.
Very fancy. But I agree. Purple prose. Time for Miss Tepp and cat poo then, yeah. Smell the dust on the road at dawn. At dawn! Okay, Amethyst, by any chance, I've been reading up the power of gems. It's a... It's water. Don't die. She's alive! We made it! Cool. It's been Amethyst, by any chance, been reading about the power of gems. Yeah, a promise ring. Never was much for jewelry, but it's grown on me. A nice piece. Tisha stands and checks her phone, surprised. It works! She notices the vibe between the two men, feeling assured the mysterious man is no threat to her. Maybe he favors Alice, but he's cute, perhaps a bit old for her. Not too bad. How do I see this internal dialogue? Remember, this is no novel. Page 11. Remember, this is not a novel. He's cute moment is impossible to visualize. Maybe she like winks at him or like smiles coyly, but you as the writer have to tell us how to visualize that. You cannot let the reader be like, maybe she's like smiling coyly, or like maybe she's like winking at him. Like, I don't know. Like, if the reader has to, because the reader is trying to play this in their mental theater. And if the reader has to figure out what the actor is doing, then you're not doing your job. So you have to make sure that you're visualizing the actor being like smiling coyly and being like, oh, he's cute. Like, whatever. Yeah, like doing like that. Because, or else the writer will get this vague sense of the scene, which is kind of what's happening. So I would
call it.
Yeah, I'm going to call this one at page 11. And it's getting late, anyways.
Mm-hmm.
Magnus is here. She needs the cone of shame. The cone of shame? I don't know how to do this cool, like, this cool blue stuff.
I know.
I'm a noob. U-turn, you caught us at the very end, but we'll go over the final notes. So good. You know.
Unique?
Yeah, like, great save the dog moment. For the protagonist. Description is vivid. Just beware getting lost in this. Yeah, so, like, it doesn't seem like it could make it slash me plus action. Ooh. Slash me plus dance? Yeah.
Ah. Yay.
Yeah. Thank you, guys. Learning new stuff. Casey Magnus, please. Bit too punchy. So, the dialogue where... And that's the thing. It's sort of the same thing that's happening with your action, where you have these great words, you have these great characters you've built, and I can actually tell you, as opposed to maybe the writer in Nuclear, have put a lot of thought into your characters and their struggles and how they're changing. However, I think you focus so much on the character you've built that you're forgetting that you have to bring the reader along to get there. So beware, like, you know, leaning so hard on that character and, like, all this stuff. Make sure that it's still clear. You're still getting the basics across before you jump into all, like, this great work you've done. Yeah, trim the details to focus core scene. The stuff like the, you know, mosaic floor flashing didn't really play much into how the scene worked out. And it ended up just kind of being a distraction. So those types of things will, like, confuse the reader. If you're throwing in a bunch of details that don't really matter and what the outcome of the story is happening, the reader's going to kind of get a bit put off. Also, the intro scene seemed a bit odd. So rework the dog lady. Odd.
Yeah.
She was quite odd. Well, great job. I mean, I think both writers, you know, it takes a lot of guts getting your stuff out there. And I know this was something that's like a little bit more like, hey, this is maybe a little bit more in progress type work. And these are the other logline notes. So, you know, one, great work. What do you think, Foxy? What should we vote for as far as the one that needs the most work versus the one? So, vote for the one that needs the edit. That's probably a bit harsh, isn't it?
Yeah.
Vote for
our favorite or something.
Yeah, vote for improvement. Improvement opportunity. That's what they called it at Target when you had feedback. Your opportunities for improvement. It was very corporate. Admires the stance mostly. Mm-hmm. If I'm writing something, what am I playing? Creative. So who do you think is the one that could have the most improvement from getting a, you know, the whole big shebang review?
Minder.
Minder? Yeah. All right, so we're going to go ahead and post this into Scriptshadow. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. And I think it is past our bedtime. Mm-hmm. So, night-night, everyone. Bye.
That's creepy. Waves a good evening. Makes perfect sense.
Boss
so eloquent.
Can't wait to see your stream, Margin Boo. Take care, guys.
Bye.
The boss folk are off to bed.